And to our newsmaker interview with the Majority Leader of the U.S. Senate, Harry Reid of Nevada. I talked with him a short time ago. Senator, welcome.
Thank you very much for allowing me to be on the show.
Well, first on the Libya military operation, do you believe the War Powers Act requires authorization of further action?
The War Powers Act has no application to what's going on in Libya.
None.
I don't believe so. You know, we did an authorization for Afghanistan. We did one for Iraq. But we have no troops on the ground there, and this thing's going to be over before you know it anyway. So I think it's not necessary.
Well, as you know, there are some of your Democratic colleagues, including Senator Durbin, your number two, feels very differently about it, feels very strongly.
He feels very differently, so.
Yeah. Why do you think the fact that U.S. troops are not on the ground, but U.S. Military hardware and equipment and personnel are involved, why the difference?
Well, I think you can see what the problem is. Speaker Boehner, they did something in the House, and Gaddafi wrote him a letter and said thanks. I mean, I think very clearly that what we're doing there is the right thing to do. I'd much rather have Gaddafi gone. I don't think the War Powers Act, when it was drafted, was meant to take this into consideration. That's how I feel, and if we arrange a vote, that's how I'll vote.
There is going to be a vote on it?
I don't know about that. You know, the Senate, there's never anything very definite about votes. I've had some long conversation with the chairman of the Foreign Relations Committee, John Kerry. I've talked to John McCain, who has strong feelings about this, and we're working to try to come up with a way to move forward on this.
Well, you know, Speaker Boehner says that if they don't do something like this in the House, he may try to keep the money away from being spent on the Libya operation.
I don't think John really believes that we should stop our actions in Libya. I mean, this madman is just that. He's a madman. The sooner he goes, the better off, and I don't think people should play around with this. We do not want Gaddafi running Libya, and so I think the speaker should be very careful about these threats.
Just so I understand, you support the president's position that it was put out in that statement, 30-some pages here a few days ago. Right?
Yes, we've talked about it, and I agree with the president.
Okay. Now, on Afghanistan, the president is due to announce very soon the schedule for an Afghanistan troop withdrawal and the size of these of the withdrawal. Where do you come down on this?
Well, the American people have war fatigue. It's been going on for a long, long time. I think the president was right when he said July 1st there's going to be a drawdown. He said that a long time ago, and there's going to be a drawdown. I am confident that it will be one that's substantial. I certainly hope so.
You're confident it will be?
Yeah, I think he's going to draw down, and I hope it's a number that is substantial.
You know, there's a report today in the Wall Street Journal which says that the military, U.S. military, is urging the president not to do a substantial.
But this is more though than the military. Mm-hmm. Much of what we're doing in that part of the world is done through our diplomatic corps, through our intelligence operations, and that's I had met with General Petraeus yesterday. We didn't go into a lot of detail about what he's recommending to the president. But this is more than what the military wants. It's what the American people want, what they need, it's what the intelligence community believes should happen there, and certainly our diplomatic corps led by Secretary Clinton.
What about the idea, though, of the so-called fighting seasons that are required in Afghanistan, and that the military says, look, let's keep our strength really strong until we get to the fall of 2012. That will assure a better military outcome in the long run, et cetera.
I'm a strong supporter of the military, but let's be realistic. In Afghanistan, the fighting season is 12 months a year. It may get a little less when the snows come, but 12 months a year. We've got provinces now in Afghanistan that have been turned over to the Afghanis, and we should continue along those lines and start bringing our troops home. They need to come home.
Now, have you said this to President Obama? Is he aware of your position on all of this?
I've talked to people in the administration. The president knows how I feel. I have told him that I hope that there's a troop withdrawal, one of significance.
And you expect that to happen?
Well, I hope so.
You don't have any inside information?
No, I have no inside information.
Do you have any idea when it's going to be announced?
I think it's going to be very soon. You know, it's a couple weeks till the first of the month, and That's the date we have, and I think I would guess maybe week after next.
Okay, let's go to domestic things. The Biden negotiations on deficit reduction and the debt ceiling. Where do they stand as we speak?
Well, I've served with Joe Biden. He does a terrific job at whatever he's involved in, and he's been very good. People like him. I have one big complaint, and that is, they shouldn't be taking breaks. They should be meeting every week, multiple times each week. And all these congressional recesses, that should have no bearing. Our country is at a very important time in the history of our country. We must reduce our debt. We must increase the debt limit. And there's no vacation during this period of time. We've got to move forward.
So if there's no agreement by the 4th of July recess, you're saying, go ahead, do not do the recess, keep talking?
What I'm saying is right now, there's a process where the House is in 2 weeks, they're out a week. I'm saying that when the Senate is in recess, we should be working on this. When the House is in recess, we should be working it. The mere fact that one of the bodies is out of work should not stop the Biden group from going forward.
What is your understanding about how close they are to coming to an agreement?
Well, there's progress being made, but until it's done, it's not done. There's still some bridges to cross. I, of course, believe that the debt is extremely important. We've got to focus on that, reduce that debt. We've got to make sure it's done fairly, though. It can't all be done on the backs of the old people, as the so-called Ryan budget wants to do, the Republicans want to do. It can't all be done with domestic discretionary spending. There are certain things we have to protect. And the Republicans seem to be very determined to protect the billionaires and millionaires. They don't want the oil companies, even though they made $37 billion profit last quarter, that they're still getting the subsidies, which even most of them say they don't need.
Republicans also say they will not go along with any tax increases. But is it possible to do what needs to be done without tax increases,
according to your opinion? According to Grover Norquist, 34 Republicans in the Senate broke that pledge yesterday when we voted to get rid of the subsidies on ethanol. So this is we're not working on a math problem. We're working in the Senate of the United States, working in the Congress. We're trying to come up with something that will help lessen the burden of debt on the American people. And there are things we can do on revenue. I think, of course, I believe that the people making more than $1 million a year should pay their fair share, as Warren Buffett and others believe. But they're obviously have locked in there. But I think that even Grover Norquist, who's been criticizing people like Coburn for breaking the tax pledge, there are ways we can do this. There has to be something done with revenue to make this fair.
So when Vice President Biden says, okay, we've had some agreement here, but the hard parts are still to come, what is he talking about?
Well, I'm sure the president's going to be making some of those decisions what the hard parts are, and I'm pretty sure that Speaker Boehner and I will be called in, and McConnell and the Speaker, I'm sorry, she's not the Speaker now, but my friend Nancy Pelosi, to find out where we should go on this. Joe Biden has done the heavy lifting. There's still a lot more to do. But in the end, as you know, the president will have to step forward.
Do you think it's going to be done?
Oh, we have no choice.
No choice?
We have no choice.
Why do we not have no choice? From your point of view, why?
Well,
I
have to say that I am very troubled with some of the, I wanted to use a word I shouldn't use, these people in the House, these Tea Party folks who say, and they've said publicly, we are not willing to raise the debt under any condition. So I'm a little concerned about that. But I think cooler heads will prevail. We cannot let the full faith and credit of the United States go down. We do. It'll not only hurt our country, it will hurt the world.
But in order to do that, $2 trillion, at least according to what has been proposed, $2 trillion in some form has to be either through tax cuts or revenue increases has to be accounted for.
I personally believe it should be more than $2 trillion.
You do?
Yes, I do. I think it should, if we could get to three, that would be terrific, but at least $2.5 trillion.
And that, of course, would be plenty enough to handle what the debt limit would be.
Oh, yes. I hope that we can do more than the debt limit. We should do it. So I'd like to do a long term, 5-6 years, but at least we need to do multiple years.
But it can't be done without revenue enhancement, in your opinion.
Well, you can't be done without revenue enhancement unless it's a take a big hammer to a situation that needs a scalpel. It is fair. I mean, the American people know that it's unfair to have oil companies, five of them, made $37 billion last quarter, and we're paying them billions of dollars in subsidies. That's not fair. That should be part of the mix.
Finally, let me ask you this, Senator. There's a new poll. Gallup had a poll in the last 24 hours about the approval rating of the Congress of the United States. 17%, according to this poll, 17% of the American people approve of the job you and your colleagues are doing. This is the lowest that rating has been since 1974. What's going on? Why do they feel this way about the
Congress? We had the most productive Congress in the history of the country, most pundits say, last Congress. My counterpart, Senator McConnell, has said his number one goal is to defeat President Obama. Well, that has put the Senate in a real slow process. He is basically, and his Republican colleagues have stopped everything we've done. Well, almost everything. We were able to push through early in this session the patent bill, which is 60 years overdue. That's reforming that is worth 300,000 jobs. We were able to reauthorize in the Senate FAA bill, Federal Aviation Administration. That's so important to do that. That's another 280,000 jobs. Those are lost over there someplace in the House. They haven't done anything with those that amounts to anything. They're talking about all these cuts, all these things dealing with women that are unnecessary, and nothing about jobs. We've tried to bring up a couple other jobs, small business innovation. That's where the electric toothbrush came from, through a very small grant, creating hundreds of thousands of jobs. They stopped that. We're going to have a cloture vote next week on the EDA bill, started during 1965. That, in the last 5 years, 314,000 jobs for $1.2 billion we invested, because there's a 7-to-1 multiplier there, because the private sector comes out $7. They've stopped that, it appears.
So it's all the Republicans' fault?
I don't like to say poor me, but the fact is they've stopped everything. They're filibustering by amendment, and when they can't do it by amendment, they just stop the bills by real filibusters.
Okay. Senator, thank you very much.
My pleasure.